We just finished basic rifle marksmanship, and we did the qualification, and we were road marching back to the barracks the next morning. Well, sometime during the night, I got bit in the thigh by a black widow. How y'all doing? Terrence Popp here with another episode. Live from the Lair. And I got a couple of emails here from some guys kind of worried about the medical care that you're going to get in the military. And they wanted me to explain certain, the medical aspect side of, being in the military. And I've already done this to a certain degree in the past. And so if I retell some of the same stuff, you just got to bear with me. But this one's going to be all about the crazy fucked up shit in regards to, medical, stuff you're going to see in the military, wounds, injuries, sicknesses, all that kind of shit. So my first experience with the medical system the military provides is when I in-processed into the MEPS down in Detroit. It was very cursory. I didn't really do much. I jumped around. I did a couple exercises. They listen to your heart, your lungs. They look in your eyes. They take a blood test. And that was pretty much it, man. It was a done deal. I mean, you really gotta, you gotta fuck shit up to get, turned back at MEPS to a certain degree. Now, there were some guys there that were, too honest and they fucked themselves. My recruiter was like, hey, look, if you do not have a piece of metal in your body and, and it still works, don't you say shit about it. Because, if it's a piece of metal and they can see it on a fucking x-ray, then you have to disclose it. Other than that, don't you say shit. You're 18, you're 17 at the time. You're fucking 17, you're in fucking destructible. Just drive the fuck on and you'll be fine. So that's how it went, I remember I did MAPS, and they don't give you your vaccinations and shit there. You get those, like, on your way into basic. So when I shipped out to Fort Benning, you go to, before you get to your, your basic training area, there's like an in-process kind of, it's called, soldier limbo. It fucking sucked. There's like 500 guys there at any one time just waiting around to get assigned to their fucking, where they're going to do their basic training at. And since I was doing basic and AIT together, I was basically going to one place for a little over 3 months just to do them both. And this was back in the day when you got all your vaccinations with an air gun. All right. Now, literally, this is where it gets kind of crazy, because you get treated like a fucking piece of cattle. They line you up in a queue, and then there's like, there's footprints on this one row, on this one hallway, and there's curtains lining the sides, and then you walk up to a box, you stand in there and you look forward, and people will, there's medics on the other side that inject you with air guns in each arm. So by the time you walk to the end of this hallway, you've probably got somewhere in the neighborhood of I want to say 9 to 13 different injections, okay, and including the smallpox, because they were vaccinating for that back in the day too. Now, normally, you will get, if you go to your civilian doctor, you get like 2 or 3 vaccinations at any one time. And then you probably feel like shit. Now, just imagine if you receive 3 to 4 times that amount in the same amount of time. Every motherfucker there, including myself, flu-like symptoms, nausea, shakes, we're just fucked up. So they pretty much, after you get your vaccinations, we were done by 2 or 3 in the afternoon. They just sent us back to our bunks, and then we ate chow and just chilled out till the next day. And a lot of people were royally fucked up. Okay. Now, there's another weird thing that happens when you throw all these people from all over the country into small areas. You get meningitis outbreaks. So when I was there, going through the in-processing. They had four cases of meningitis, and one of them, I don't know if he died, but I never saw that guy again. The other three guys were laid up for, you know, like 2 or 3 days or whatever, and they were sent back, and they were under observation, which meant they just didn't do drill and ceremony in the parking lot. And they're okay. But that does happen. The meningitis shit is no fucking joke. And that's basically where the, you know, the lining that surrounds your brain gets irritated either through a viral or bacterial infection. And it could, it'll straight up kill you, if not turn you into a vegetable. So that, you got to be wary of that. All right, so I went to basic. I saw a ton of injuries when I was there. Most of them were heat injuries. And I remember we were doing it, I think it was an 8-mile speed march. And one of the guys up ahead of me, it was a fat body. You know, we're about 4 or 5 miles into it, starts doing the Elvis walk. And that's where you start, like, you watch him. He's like, he's about to go down. And, you know, it's hot as fuck out because I believe it was August, you know, in Benning. August is fucking pretty fucking hot. And the guy goes down, you know, and we were doing, it's a 4-mile loop. So this happened just as we were finishing the first loop and we're coming around for the second loop. And by the time I came by to, you know, to the second loop, he had a poncho over him and that dude was deader than shit. You know, he had basically had a heat stroke and died on the scene. And it was very unfortunate. But, you know, you are training for war and your mommy and daddy aren't there. And, you know, you can get severely injured and fucking die because it's serious fucking business. It's not a sport. So, you know, he burned in. And that was pretty much the first dude that I'd ever actually seen up and close. Is I, you know, I was up super close, but I walked like within 10 feet of the guy, and you know, he was under the poncho. You could see his hand and his arm and part of his leg, and it was weird because, you know, this guy was sitting like the next table over from me that morning eating breakfast, and by 4 o'clock in the afternoon he was dead. Okay, and he didn't even look like a real person. He looked like he was made of rubber. That was weird. Okay, and that was like that was the first time I ever saw any crazy shit like that. And, you know, it gave me some nightmares, you know, fucked with me for a while. But, you know, you fucking get over it. And let's see, in basic training, we just finished basic rifle marksmanship. And we did the qualification. And we were road marching back to the barracks the next morning. Well, sometime during the night, I got bit in the thigh by a black widow. Now, how did I know it was a black widow? Because apparently after it was biting me, I killed it in my sleep. And then I found its body, you know, crushed body in the morning. And you can see the fucking, the red hourglass on the belly of the fucking spider. So I knew I was fucked. But, you know, I don't want to be that guy. I'm like, okay, I'll be, you know, fuck it. You know, I'm young, I'm healthy, I'll be fine. I rock up, I'd pound some water. We road marched back to the barracks. It was like, I think it was like 6 miles in, I'm not sure. Maybe a little more, I remember. But by the time we walk in to the Starship, because I was in Sand Hill, Alpha 5-1, I don't think it's still there anymore, but I literally had tunnel vision. I was all clammy. I was profusely sweating. You know, I had like low-grade nausea. And I remember like they pulled me aside and like, what's going on? And I'm like, I'm fucked up. I got bit by a black widow. And they're like, oh, really? Huh? So I remember the platoon guide, we used to call him Lockjaw, goes in there and, you know, he walks into the office where the drill sergeants are at. And our drill sergeant come out, it was Drill Sergeant Moore. So it was Sergeant First Class at the time. I think he retired as Sergeant Major. He was all right. I didn't really, I mean, as a professional, he was good. As a human being, he wasn't. I didn't really like the guy. But he comes and gets me, walks me out to his car. We get in his car, we drive out to the fucking, the hospital that's on Benning. And they sit me down, they go through the fucking deal, they look in my eyes, they do the nerve tests and shit like that to take a blood fucking sample, and then they fucking scold me about how I fucking am an idiot, and, you know, I got bit by a poisonous fucking spider, and it could fucking kill you, blah, blah, blah. And by this time, I had, like, a fever of, like, 103, I had the shakes, you know, I had muscle cramping, I had, you know, abdominal cramping really bad, and I had a cramp that was, like, going up and down my fucking spine, my muscles were, like, fucking seizing up, and then it was bad. So I'm laying there, and they basically give me a bed, and I'm laying there, and they hook me up to an IV, and they come in with an antivenom, and they shoot it into the IV. And imagine, you know, you've been carrying like 100 pounds on your fucking back all day. You are exhausted. You are in pain. You are just miserable. And all of a sudden, the weight gets lifted. The pain goes away. And, you know, it was like somebody just dialed the suck factor from 11 down to 2. And they kept me for observation until the next morning, and then they released me back to the drill sergeant. I went back, and I was on quarters, and I slept for like 36 hours fucking straight, you know, and that was fucking weird. But, you know, the whole time I was there, nobody gave a fuck about you. You're just a fucking piece of meat that they got to keep alive and functioning, and I mean, that's the trade-off, okay? Same thing happened when I was in the MFO mission. I got stung by a scorpion and blew it off, and then I got all fucked up and had to go on sick call, and they had to cut a bunch of neurotic tissue out and put me on antibiotics and give me a bunch of IVs and shit, and I got yelled at for that too. But I don't know, just I wrote it out. I mean, the venom from the scorpion wasn't, I mean, I was sick, but I wasn't any more sick or up fucked up than I was by the black widow bite. And but the thing that really fucked with me is after I wrote out the venom, you know, we're now in the third or fourth day after the fucking sting, and the tissue and the bite is fucking rotten and it's getting all fucked up. And they had to basically go in there, they give you Novocaine, and they fucking cut it out and give you antibiotics and yell at you and accuse you of fucking with it, which I really wasn't. But it, you know, was partially my fault. I didn't, you know, I was on the beach. I didn't shake out my fucking pants before I put them on, and I got fucked up. I mean, good thing it didn't sting me in the dick. Thank God for small favors. Let's see. While in the 9th Infantry Division, I remember I had strep throat. And I would go on sick call. And they, you know, you're talking to a medic. You're not even talking to, like, an actual doctor or warrant officer or... And these are just fucking basic medics. They have a flow chart, and like, oh yeah, okay, you have sore throat, you have fever, no, okay, we're gonna give you some Tylenol and go back and come back in 3 days if it's still bothering you. Well, after this had happened like 3 or 4 fucking times, you know, I had basically reached the end of the rope. I mean, I was fucked up, sick, you know, and like I think it was like the 4th or 5th time I went in there, I actually had a 102 fever, and then that's when they start taking you serious, because, you know, you're 18 years old, if you have a fever, some shit's going down. So they took me to the mat again, gave me a chest x-ray, boom, I have walking pneumonia. So I get fucking automatically, I'm there for 2 days with IV antibiotics, oral antibiotics, you know, all kinds of fucked up shit. And all of it could have been avoided if they just would have gave me the fucking, you know, a test for strep throat in the beginning and then gave me the antibiotics. And I wouldn't, because it took months to recover. It took like 2.5 months to recover from that. And even to this day, you know, I still hack up and, you know, cough a lot, even though I've never smoked in my life, not even once. But yeah, I mean, that's the way it's going to be. And, you know, it's the trade-off. And the same thing when I went to the Ranger Battalion, you know, that you get all your fucking shots, your booster shots, except the difference is, instead of, you know, waiting in a big fucking line where everyone's getting it done, it's just your platoon and your medic will come and, you know, do what you got to do. And usually they just give you boosters by then. And usually every time you will go to the field, you'll get like a tetanus booster or maybe measles, mumps, rubella. You know, and if you went down to South America as a grunt, usually they give you a rabies shot, and it's basically it primes your immune system for rabies, just because there's so many fucking vampire bats and shit down there in South America, and you don't even know if they bite you in your sleep or not, because you really won't feel it, because their saliva has like some kind of numbing agent in it, and they'll fucking lick you clean, and they'll lick you like a stamp, and you know, and they'll fly off, they have their blood meal, and you can fucking be, you know, hooked up with rabies and not even know it. So usually, if you're going to operate down there, you're going to get a fucking rabies shot, and it fucking hurts. The rabies shot's burned. Okay, another one they give you that sucks is the Gamma Goblin. I don't think they do that anymore, but they keep it in the refrigerator, and it feels like you're getting freezing cold cookie dough injected into your fucking ass, because that's where they give it to you, and then you can feel it running down your leg, you know, inside, as you know it dissipates, you can feel the coldness like go down your leg, and people were passing out on that one left and right. I think we had like one out of four guys fucking choke up and pass out on that, and that was hilarious. I myself did not pass out. I'm not a fainter, but it did hurt like fuck. So, you know, I'm not going to lie. You know, there was a little whimpering there. You know, I was 19, 20 years old. What are you going to do? Okay, so we covered the Black Widow, the Scorpion. Oh, yeah. All right. Now, this is going to happen if you go into the Marines or into the United States Army. And it may happen more than once. Usually it happens every 6 months. We're talking about food poisoning. All right. So, you know, I was out there in second bat. They go pick up the mermites, which are basically giant, thermal storage devices for the food, whatever. And they bring them out, and you get a paper plate, and they load up your fucking shit, and they give it to you. Now, if they don't clean that shit properly, or if that food sits in there too long, you're going to catch a case, all right? You're going to catch a case of swamp ass, a case of projectile vomiting, or worst case scenario, you're going to be doing both at the same time, basically sitting on the toilet, downloading your entire intestine into the bowl, and holding a garbage fucking pail, vomiting into that at the same time. And you may or may not have an IV while this is all going on. It all depends how many people were affected. In my case, the entire platoon, minus like four guys, were fucked up. Sorry. I mean, we're so fucked up. They had to call a cattle car out to get us and take us back to Fort Lewis because we're at Yakima. And we were fucking down for like 4 days. And some people got fucking fired and fucked up. Nobody died, thank God. Nobody had any permanent fucking bullshit going on, but that was a rough 3 days, and that's probably the worst I've ever been food poisoned in my life. You know, I've had it before in the Army, in the military, most of the time, because I have a cast iron stomach. I just eat whatever they give me, and if I have a problem, very rarely will I vomit. I'll usually just, you know, shit my brains out and then just drive on. But yeah, you will get food poisoning. All right, now, I said you get the IVs and stuff if you're lucky. Now, when you are young, you can do all kinds of crazy shit to your meat suit and get away with it. Like, you can literally start drinking at 7 o'clock in the evening, stop at 3 in the morning, lay down, and get up at 5:45 for PT. You will have a hangover, but you can still run 5 miles in 40 minutes or less. How do I know that? I did it myself. I've seen it done many times. But when you come back from that run, you are going to be doubly depleted, and you are going to need an IV, because when you get that dehydrated, you can literally pound a gallon of water at 9 o'clock in the morning. You are going to feel like shit all day long until about 4 or 5 in the afternoon. And that's when your body will just be starting to get caught up on being rehydrated. So if you know the medic like I did, you just go down to his office. Hey, I'm fucking fucked up. I was drinking last night. I ran PT. Can I get an IV? And usually there's always a new medic that needs practice on doing the IVs. And you go in there, lay on the table. Now you'll get 2 or 3 sticks. They give you 1.5 liters of juice. Inside of 35 minutes, you're right as rain. And I've seen it done many times. Is that an abuse, you know, of medical supplies? Yes and no, because there are people there who are getting real-world training value out of you being an idiot. Okay, it happened all the time. All right, now, I saw a guy get stitches in his nutsack in the drop zone when I was at second bat. He basically tore his scrotum open on a jump. His H harness wasn't fucking sitting right, and fucking opening shock was bad, and boom, he needed to get like 5 or 6 stitches in his bean bag. And I didn't really know this at the time, but your scrotum, that shit bleeds pretty much as bad as your scalp, because by the time this individual made it back to the, you know, the rally point, because he was 45 minutes late, he was literally covered in blood from his belly button down to his boots. And he was fucked up, sorry. But did he go to Madigan, the hospital? No. Did he get a Novocaine? No. He just got 5 fucking stitches in his beanbag and thrown on the fucking chute recovery vehicle and sent back to the barracks, and he rode it out. You know, I think he was good to go. I've seen guys get stitches in their fingers, toes, and their face. You know, I've actually, you know, give some stitches to a couple guys. I stitched my own face up 3 times over my left eye and 5 or 6 times on the hairline from headbutts when I used to fight. And, you know, so I'm no medic. You know, I'm going to be honest. I am no fucking medic. I just know how to give IVs, tourniquets, treat for shock, treat for dehydration, you know, and shit like that, man. I can patch bullet wounds, take care of sucking chest wounds, give you a splint, you know, or what have you. But, you know. All right. Yeah. And don't ever go to the medics with like a hurt finger and go, oh, I need a splint for my finger, because this is what they're going to do. They're going to take the hurt finger and they're going to tape it to the unhurt finger. And then they're going to give you the 2 fingers and tell you to fuck off and drive on. So that's the way it's going to go with that. So don't same thing with toes. They don't care about your toes or fingers. Okay, it's just the way it is. Okay, all right. I think I'm going to cut this one short here, and then we'll just, because I have a whole other round of fucking stories I've seen, you know, Joe get fucked up with over the years, and some of them are pretty exotic.